The name of the topic is Our Changing Earth. Now, what are we going to learn after going through the entire topic? So, in this video, we are going to develop an understanding regarding first about the lithospheric plates, second about the forces which are responsible for the movement of the lithospheric plates, third we will read about the volcanoes and the earthquakes, and lastly, we'll talk about the various landforms made by the agents such as the rivers, the sea waves, the glaciers, and the wind in the desert. So let us start. First, we will be talking about the lithospheric plates. So what do we mean by this? So the lithosphere is broken into a number of plates which are known as the lithospheric plates. In other words, the Earth's crust consists of several large and small, rigid, irregularly shaped plates which can carry continents and the ocean floor. And these plates move around very slowly. Slowly, we can say that just a few millimeters each year. Now, why? So, this is because of the movement of the molten magma inside the Earth. This molten magma inside the Earth moves in a circular manner. And the movement of these plates causes the changes on the surface of the Earth. And the Earth's movements are divided on the basis of the forces which cause them. So what are the forces which cause these movement in the lithospheric plates? Let us see. First, the forces which acts in the interior of the Earth are called the endogenic forces. Whereas, the forces that work on the surface of the Earth are called the exogenic forces. Now, what are these two types of forces? So, endogenic forces are further classified into sudden forces and disastrophic forces. Whereas, sudden forces, what could be these sudden forces? So, examples of such sudden forces include the earthquake, the volcano, the landslides. Whereas, the diastrophic surfaces include building mountains. Now, sudden movements like earthquakes and volcanoes can cause mass destruction over the surface of the Earth. And what are the exogenic forces? Because right now we just talked about the endogenic. So, exogenic forces comprise of erosional and depositional, which further includes the river, the wind, sea waves and the glaciers. So, this was about the lithospheric plates and about the various forces which are responsible for the movement of the lithospheric plates. Now, after talking about the lithospheric plates and the forces which are responsible for the movement of these plates, let us talk about the volcanoes and the earthquakes. So, a volcano is a vent or an opening in the Earth's crust through which the molten material erupts suddenly. So, this is the volcano. But what is an earthquake? So, when the lithospheric plates move, the surface of the Earth vibrates. And these vibrations can travel all around the Earth. And these vibrations are called the earthquakes. The place in the crust where the movement starts is called the focus, whereas the place on the surface above the focus is called the epicenter. Greatest damage is usually closer, or we can say the greatest damage which is caused is usually closest to the epicenter. And the strength of the earthquake decreases away from the center. There are three types of earthquake waves: P waves, S waves and L waves. P waves are also called longitudinal waves, S waves are called transverse waves, and L waves are also called surface waves. Now, although earthquakes cannot be predicted, the impact can certainly be minimized if we are prepared beforehand. So, some common earthquake prediction methods adopted locally by people include studying the animal behavior. Fish, for example, the fishes in the ponds get agitated, snakes also come to the surface. So, these are some common methods, or we can say some local methods. An earthquake is measured with a machine which is called a seismograph. And the magnitude of the earthquake is measured on the Richter scale. An earthquake of 2 or less can be felt only a little. However, An earthquake over 5 can cause damage from things falling. And a 6 or a higher magnitude of earthquake is considered very strong. And 7 magnitude is classified as a major earthquake. So this was about the volcanoes and the earthquake. Now, the third aspect that we are going to discuss is about the various landforms made by the agents. The landscape is being continuously formed with the help of agents such as the rivers, glaciers, wind, etc. by two processes, namely weathering and erosion. So what are these two processes? Erosion is wearing away of the landscape by different agents like water, wind and ice. Whereas weathering is the breaking up of the rocks on the earth's surface. The eroded material in case of erosion is carried away or transported by water, wind, etc. and it eventually gets deposited. Now this process of erosion and deposition create different landforms on the surface of the earth. So what are the different landforms? So let us discuss. Now landforms which are made by the river. So following landforms are created by the river, namely the waterfall, the meanders, the Oxbow Lake, the floodplains and leaves, and distributaries and the delta. So we will be discussing each of these now. Now let us move on to talk about the waterfalls. What do we mean by a waterfall? Well, when the river tumbles at steep angle over very hard rocks or down a steep valley side, it forms a waterfall. Then there are thousands of small and big waterfalls in the world. However, the highest waterfall is the Angle Falls of Venezuela, which is in South America. And other important waterfalls, or we can say other famous waterfalls, are the Niagara Falls, which is located on the border between Canada and USA in North America, and Victoria Falls, which is on the borders of Zambia and Zimbabwe in Africa. So this was about the waterfalls. Now second is about meanders. What do we mean by meanders? So as the river enters the plain, it twists and turns, forming large bends which are known as meanders. Now after defining the waterfalls and the meanders, let us move on to talk about Oxbow Lake. Now due to continuous erosion and deposition along the sides of the meander, the ends of the meander loop come closer and closer. And in due course of time, the meander loop cuts off from the river and forms a cut-off lake. And that cut-off lake is also called an Oxbow Lake. So this is about Oxbow Lake. And then floodplain and leaves. So at the times, there are times the river overflows its banks, which leads to flooding of the neighboring areas. Now as it floods, it deposits layers of fine soil and other material which are called sediments along its banks. This leads to the formation of a flat, fertile floodplain. And these raised banks are called levees. So after discussing about this, let us move on to discuss or define distributaries and delta. So as the river approaches the sea, the speed of the flowing water decreases and the river begins to break up into a number of streams which are called the distributaries. Now the river becomes so slow that it begins to deposit its load, and each distributary forms its own mouth, and the collection of sediments from all the mouths forms a delta. So this was about the various landforms made by the river, which were namely the waterfall, the meanders, the Oxbow Lake, the floodplains and the distributaries and delta. Now, let us talk about the landforms which are made by sea waves. So, by sea waves, these are the landforms which are created. First, sea caves. Second, sea arcs. Third, stacks. Fourth, sea cliff. And fifth, beaches. So, first we will discuss about the sea caves. So sea caves are continuously striking at the rocks and therefore cracks develop within them. And over the time, they become larger and wider. Thus, hollow-like caves are formed on the rocks, which are called as the sea caves. But what are sea arches? As sea caves' cavities become bigger and bigger, only the roof of the caves remains, thus forming the sea arcs. So this is about the sea caves and the sea arcs. Then we will define stacks. So further erosion of the sea caves breaks the roof and only the walls are left. In this case, these wall-like features are called stacks. Then we will discuss sea cliff. Now we will define sea cliff. The steep rocky coast rising almost vertically above sea water is called the sea cliff. And then what do we mean by the beaches? Well, the sea waves that deposit sediments along the shores, they form the beach. So this was about the landforms which are created by the sea waves, which were namely the sea caves, sea arcs, stacks, sea cliff and the beaches. Now what are the landforms which are made by ice glaciers? So they are namely the lakes and the glacial moraines. So let us talk about them. So lakes, as we know, that glaciers which carve out deep hollows on mountains, and as the ice melts, they get filled up with water, which becomes the beautiful lakes of the mountains. But what are glacial moraines? The material which is carried by the glacier, such as rocks, big and small, sand and silt that gets deposited, then these deposits form the glacial moraines. Now let us discuss about the landforms which are made by the wind in the deserts. They are namely the mushroom rocks, the sand dunes and the loess. So what are mushroom rocks? Well, in deserts we can see rocks in the shape of a mushroom which are called the mushroom rocks. And in mushroom rocks, the winds erode the lower section of the rock more than the upper part. Therefore, such rocks have narrower base as compared to their top. Now what are sand dunes? Well, when the wind blows, it lifts and transports sand from one place to another. And when it stops blowing, the sand falls and gets deposited in a low hill like structures. These structures are called the sand dunes. But what are loess? Well, when the grains of sand are very fine and light, the wind can carry it over very long distances. When such sand is deposited in large areas, it is called loess. Large deposits of loess is found in China. So that's all. Thank you.